What's the first thing you think about when you hear the word fossil? I'll bet it's dinosaurs. Or it could be fossils that you might collect yourself, shelly things like ammonites maybe. What you may not realise is that some fossils aren't from animals. Some fossils are the preserved remains of plants. If we travel back 300 million years, we would be surrounded by huge, dense, swampy forests. These forests were dominated by plants like club mosses and horsetails, which we find today, but back in the Carboniferous, they formed huge tree-like forms. It's these forests that formed the coal that drove the Industrial Revolution. These forests harvested carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, and then it was locked away in that coal for millions of years. Then we humans dug up that coal and burnt it for heat and for power over a couple of centuries. A blink of the eye, geologically speaking. The current climate crisis has its roots, at least in part, in fossil forests that are older than the dinosaurs. One of the best things about studying fossil plants is what they can tell us about past environments. It's like having really finely tuned environmental sensors scattered through time. Even the shape of a leaf can tell you something about the environment that that plant grew in. Something like a leaf with a drip tip that allows water to drip off the leaf will tell you that a plant grew in a tropical, wet environment. Some plant fossils preserve the outer waxy layer of the leaf called the cuticle. In those fossils, we can see air pores, the stomata, which the plant uses to allow carbon dioxide in and to release oxygen during photosynthesis. We know from experiments on living plants that plants produce fewer stomata or air pores when they're grown at higher concentrations of carbon dioxide. This means that for plants that have living relatives, we can use their fossil leaves as carbon dioxide sensors through deep time. Not all plant fossils are as big as these ones we've got here. The pollen and spores that plants produce gets preserved too. And palynologists dissolve those rocks with acids to extract the pollen and the spores and to study them under the microscope. Because plants produce large amounts of pollen and spores, and they get carried far away from the parent plant, this means that these samples give us an excellent record of changes in regional plant life. It also means that the samples are much more statistically valid than finding one or two really big but rare plant fossils. Fossil spores can also contain chemical signatures which can even tell us about UV levels in the past. Fossil sunshine. Plant fossils can also tell us a lot about how plants have evolved. Today, one plant group dominates the planet, the angiosperms, or flowering plants. These are the plants that we eat, the plants which we choose to plant in our gardens, and the plants that provide most of our natural environments. But flowering plants only appeared about 130 million years ago. Darwin called this an abominable mystery. But you don't have to look too far today to find plants whose ancestors were around well before the flowers. You can find liverworts and mosses, club mosses, horsetails, ferns, even cycads and conifers. Keep your eyes open for these plant survivors from deep time when you're out and about. They can help us to understand the plant fossil record and also give us a better understanding of how ecosystems worked in the past.